Hey everyone, my name is Antonio Diaz. I'm the founder and editor-in-chief of Life and Time, and we want to really thank you for attending our second webinar here during this time of quarantine. And we've got so many incredible webinars coming up soon as well. And if you're a paid member for Life and Time, we want to thank you. You kind of make our editorial engine chug along, so we really appreciate it. And if you're not a paid member and you enjoy this webinar, feel free to join us at lifeandtime.com. But we have so much to talk about today, and this is a very, very special webinar because we have three panelists from three different countries joining us today. And our Life and Time correspondent, Elena Valeriote, is also based in Tuscany, Italy, who's going to be moderating this panel. And I'm gonna have her take it from here.
All right, thanks, Antonio. And thank you to everyone who's joining us today. We have a really wonderful, really international group of people with us. And I'm really excited to have them talk. So I'll let them introduce themselves in just a second. As Antonio said, I'm a correspondent with Life and Time, and I'm here in Tuscany, Italy. And Italy, unfortunately, was one of the places hit hard early on by the effects of COVID-19. And being here on the farm and in Italy, I've seen some of the impacts on the Italian food supply chain up close. And as devastating as the situation has been here and elsewhere, I'm also seeing some really inspiring things, especially by the people that are with us here today on the panel, that are going on around the world to preserve and strengthen local foodways. So I'm eager to let them get a chance to talk to you guys. So to start, we're going to have each of you on the panel tell us a little bit about yourself and where you're calling from. And also, since we're going to be talking for the next hour about food, maybe tell us something that you've made during quarantine at home that either turned out especially well or maybe went really wrong. So Kat, we'll go ahead and start with you.
Hello everyone, good evening, good morning. I am Caterina, so I'm based in Italy, in Udine, which is in the northeastern part of Italy. It's very, very close to the borders with Slovenia, Austria, and I mean, we're not like border with Croatia, but we're very, very close. So I manage l'Orto Felice, which means the happy garden in English. It's an organic farm. It's my family farm. It's been in my family for generations. We grow all sorts of organic veggies. We've been certified for more than 30 years now. So we grow veggies, we grow aromatic and also like wild and spontaneous plants. And we also grow more than 70 varieties of ancient beans. We're very much rooted in our like local food environment. The farm is around 8 hectares. I don't know the equivalent in acres, but we're kind of a urban farm. We're really based in the city because it used to be countryside before. I mean, when my grandfather bought the land, but now the city has grown basically around us. We're not super, super close to the epicenter of COVID-19, because I mean, you know, as you guys may know, the biggest part of the epidemics was around the area of Milano and Bergamo, and it's in northern Italy, but it's really in the center of the state, and we're more on the eastern side. So, I mean, luckily here the situation is pretty good, it's pretty under control, and I think over the past couple of days we had zero cases, of like zero new cases of people that have been like affected by COVID. The measures have been pretty strict, but we're gonna talk about that maybe later, but we have just entered the second phase. The phase two, so-called. So Italy is very slowly opening up a little bit again. Talking about what I was able to experiment here during this lockdown, first and foremost, I have to say that I didn't have that much time to cook a lot because spring is the busiest season here. And on top of that, we've been opened throughout the whole pandemic. Weekends are good times for me to cook. And so I've been fermenting quite a lot. Aside from what we do on the farm, I'm keeping my sourdough nice and alive. And one thing I really like to do, especially when I feel like I'm lazy, it's to do sourdough tacos. It's not real tacos. It's just like to use all the sourdough leftovers. And it's super easy, super quick to do. And it goes well with everything, basically, especially with our veggies. So.
Great. Thank you, Katerina. Let's come to you next, Johnny.
Me? Already? Excellent.
So
my name is Johnny Rhodes. I'm the chef and the owner of Restaurant Indigo, the chef and owner of Broham Fine Soul Food and Groceries. We created Broham as a pivot to everything that's kind of happened. We were already working towards creating a more sustainable grocery store or 100% grocery store. It wasn't projected to really start taking place until the end of the year. But everything that happened kind of forced us to pivot and adjust quickly and rapidly. And the way the concept of our restaurant is set up around inventory and around having reserves as a means of combating food apartheid. And in us doing that, it made the transition for us to transfer into a grocery store very, very easily, very quickly. We turned around our business model and basically turned our business model from a fine dining tasting menu restaurant to a fine soul food grocery store in a matter of 2 weeks. It wasn't easy by any stretch of the imagination, and our team had to work really, really hard and diligently to get those things done. But it was something that we felt was extremely necessary to do for our community because as things get worse and worse, a lot of people, a lot of places are relying on grocery stores. I come from a community where we don't have those things. So we had to create those things to be able to make sure people didn't have to commit crimes to get food. A lot of times people from our community often commit crimes in correlation to a lack of having food. And then those crimes end up leaving in prison or penitentiaries for X amount of years. And now here we are at this point trying to solve that issue with food.
Thanks so much, Johnny. And then we're going to come next to you, Santiago.
Hi, I'm Santiago Arango. I'm a partner of a hospitality group. My role is general manager of the brands in the company. We are based in Bogota, the capital of Colombia. We only have the operation here in Bogota, in the capital. We have 28 restaurants, 15 brands, and more than 1,000 employees right now, which are locked down, waiting for the opening of the restaurants. A small part of the company is directly working in the operations, in the restaurants that have delivery operations or takeout operations, and in other initiatives that I'm gonna talk about here that we launched for this crisis. And that's a little bit about me.
All right, great. All right, so Johnny, I'd like to come back to you for the first sort of question here, because you have a really interesting perspective. We're talking about Foodways today, and you work at some of the major points of the food system, essentially running a restaurant, working with a garden, working with suppliers, and now delving into grocery. So you've brought up your grocery store, and I want to hear more about it, sort of how you managed to open it at this time and such a quick turnaround, why it was so important to you to do it now, and some of the things that influence your sourcing choices for this restaurant. I mean, the grocery store connected to your restaurant.
I would say it was, like I said earlier, poverty. Oftentimes when we talk about poverty and we talk about crime, the correlation of food is often completely left out. But I've grown up listening to hip hop, and I've grown up living in my community to where people are literally committing crimes to put food on the table. And then oftentimes we often look at those crimes as being, you know, heartless or inhumane, but we never look at what caused it, you know, the why. And often the why, which leads to further down the road of institutionalism, is what creates those problems of not having, which is what creates those problems or stems from those problems of not having access to quality food. We have kids in our community, and Houston is one of the largest places for break-in, for car break-ins, but breaking in the cars to pay their mortgage, right? People are breaking in the cars to pawn or sell whatever they have, and then they're going and getting in line at McDonald's or Burger King or another fast food spot, which only furthers and triggers down that that cycle of not having food access and then being penalized for not having food access and doing what you feel you need to be able to feed yourself. Under us recognizing that and understanding that, I felt like it was dire that we, you know, make these things happen. But just simply because with the COVID going on, everybody's talking about, you know, your immune system. If you grew up here in our community, what immune system, right? There's no vitamin C, there's no fresh oranges, only chips, sodas, and snacks, and things of that magnitude. And I imagine trying to build your immune system to fight off COVID, and there's no actual nutrition in the food in which you're consuming. And then you talk about, often education is the thing that's talked about, but people in our community know about these things. They're just in it, there just isn't access to them.
And so could you talk to you a little bit about your sourcing at your grocery store? I know it's very important to you who you're buying from as well as where.
Right. Sourcing, I would say, is probably, if not, it shares a spot with inventory for grocery stores. For restaurants, sourcing is the most important thing. For grocery stores, sourcing and inventory kind of share the spotlight together. Now, with that being said, sourcing for us is extremely important because we want to use only local farmers, and eventually we want to be sustainable and produce everything ourselves. But it's so important for us to use only local farmers because you see produce in grocery stores that come from all over the world and all the really. But a lot of that produce that comes from all over the country doesn't come from local farmers and local people that live in the country that create the food. They come from profit for prison farms. You know, prisons that have farms, and you have inmates that grow the food, and those things are then sold to grocery stores. So when you look at, you know, things like rural white America, who's experiencing, you know, not being growing things and not being able to sell them, they have to go to farmers markets and sell them when they really should be able to put those products in grocery stores. And that's the plight of African Americans. We can't even get the land to be able to sell in grocery stores. Anything else, because we're still experiencing modern day slavery through profit through private prisons, growing and selling food to grocery stores, which is just a morale. It's just terrible.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, Johnny. And Santiago, you similarly to Johnny opened a sort of market during the pandemic in this period of a very short time. Could you tell us a little bit about Dispensas Akami and what sort of inspired you to do that right now?
Yeah, so we were, after we had to close the restaurant, our main concern was employees. Not that I am categorizing it, but the suppliers and the rent. Those were our big focuses for the crisis. So in the supplier side, we saw that there were going to be a lot of small farmers or suppliers that were catering directly to us, and that they were going to lose that channel of sales with all the restaurants closed here in Colombia. So we set it up in a few days, an Instagram account, and then it's a virtual market in which we chose those small suppliers like caring about their size and their reachability to the final customers, and we selected them and we put it in a virtual market, and that was the main purpose, to connect the final customers or a regular customer of our restaurants, or that weren't able to find those ingredients in any supermarket or regular grocery store here in Bogota. And it has been a huge success in the way that unit of that business unit now is selling the same as a very successful restaurant from our company. And with all of the challenges of the retail or the logistics, and we started sending the boxes of markets 3 days after they ordered, and now we're now 1 day after, and we've learned a lot, but it's growing, and I think that it's a concept that's gonna be still there after the crisis, and that's the main purpose, to stay with this new concept and to grow it so more suppliers can be part of it. Like we have a line of suppliers asking us to put them in the market, and that has been very interesting and very fulfilling right in this moment.
Great. And so for all three of you, your businesses are really connected to the idea of local food. And so this sort of local food movement is fairly new, but local food was simply a way of life for most of human history. And it's only recently that this movement has taken off. And in the US, unfortunately, there is sort of this conception now that local food is elitist. And I was wondering if, Johnny, you could speak a little bit to why you think this might be.
You said that local food is what again?
A little elitist. That sort of for an exclusive group of people.
Well, I think that's where we talk about agricultural oppression. Local food is elitist, and it is elitist simply because if you don't have the access to land, then how can you have access to local foods, right? As we just talked about in our community, how everybody is surviving off of food snacks, chips and sodas and things like that. None of that stuff is local, and they don't have access to it. But if you go, 5-10 miles up the road to a community that doesn't quite look like mine, they literally have fruit trees where we have concrete. So, I mean, when we talk about food apartheid and agricultural oppression is the in-access to land and to be able to live sustainable, to grow your own food. And then food apartheid is where even if you don't have land, you don't have access to quality food in your neighborhood. So I think with those two things being the vocal point, local definitely become elitist, but become elitist because we're looking at that human battle of innovation versus tradition. We've gotten so innovative that we've moved away from tradition, and we need both of them to be able to survive. Right now, as humans, we want everything at the tips of our fingers. We want everything can be shipped across the country, everything can be shipped across the world, instead of having that compassion of enjoying something in the moment, right? We share too much, but we share too much in the wrong ways. We should be sharing, food very easily. There's no reason for food to be so scarce, but it is because we share how we do it, but we don't share the actual product with each other, unless it comes at a cost.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you. And Katerina, I'm interested to know what you think the perception of local food is in Italy. I know there's a similar movement, the Kilometro Zero. Do you think that people in Italy view local food as more accessible and affordable?
I mean, yes, I do think so. I mean, I think it's, Italy and the US, they're very different in their food system, because of the size of the countries as well, and of many other factors. I would say that in Italy, local food is more present, and it's kind of, I would say, more accessible, because there has been a culture of local food forever, in the sense that Italian cuisine is based on local food. Italian cuisine is based on the peculiarity of a specific terroir, a specific region, a specific little town. So I think for sure that there is this, I mean, people are kind of like used to that in the sense. And I mean, Italy is also like a very big, like a fruits and vegetable producer. So we are kind of one of the biggest producers of food for Europe. Like we are a food hub for other countries. We export quite a lot. So, and then it's also like what's local. Like, do we speak about like more than 100 kilometers, less? I mean, it really depends on which country you're located in, which area you're operating. This being said, there is also in Italy a lot of discussions on, you know, like local food being elitist in a way, and local and organic food being elitist, because there is like a lot of, you know, let's say common sense saying that organic food is more expensive, that it's something that not everyone can afford. And I think, you know, there's, we have to approach, let's say, things in from like different sides, different facets. I would say that, I mean, local and organic food is for sure more expensive than industrially produced food. But there is also one thing that we never take into account whenever we speak about like industrial produced food, which is the real cost of it. Be it like on an environmental side, but also on the social side. And it's something that I never get tired to speak about, which is like, what's the real price? What's the real cost of what you eat? And it's like, you know, if you're willing to pay your kilo of tomatoes, and we have examples of that in Italy, if you're willing to pay 1 kilo of tomatoes, 1 euros, I mean, how can you be sure that the farmer is actually paying himself, that he's paying his employees, that they're having like a job contract or whatever, and that he's taking care of the land? Because I mean, even just taking care of the land and applying like regenerative agriculture or organic agriculture like practices, it's expensive because you use it like a different approach. And I think there's also one other thing that is very important, which is that, I don't know about guys in Colombia or in the US, but I think there is one thing that it's very important here, is that we're used to pay our food not enough. Like we spend like more money on stuff that is useless, and food that it's literally the stuff that we put in our body. We're not ready to invest on that. And this is a conversation, but it's more like on a macroeconomic and political also standpoint. And I think that, you know, so let's say in Italy we eat like a bit more local food, probably comparing to other countries because our food tradition. But I think that there is here as well the culture of the all year round availability of produce, which is like, you know, so something that was probably not there until even like a decade or a couple of decades ago. Like here now you can find tomatoes in December here as well. Like it's and they do not come from Italy, so. Yeah, it's fine balance.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And Santiago, I'm interested to hear the Colombian perspective on this. I know local food is important at Grupo Tacami, but what do you think in general of Bogota or people feel about local food?
I think that we're like going towards local food. Of course, it's more expensive than what you find in a supermarket. And I think that there are customers that are valuing that. And that's part of our mission, connecting those suppliers with our final customers that appreciate that. But of course, because of our location, we have a lot of influence from the US, and our system is not as developed or industrialized as the US. But we have a mixture of local producers, but a little bit of more industrialized producers. And what we as a company, we are trying to focus and develop with them their production systems, their distribution systems. So those suppliers are the ones that are going to survive and to stay in the market. Of course, we have the 1 euro tomato kilo here. Of course, we have everything. And I think in the US, that's a big thing there. We as restaurateurs or like the ones who transform those ingredients to serve a plate, that's our responsibility to choose those suppliers and to support those suppliers. And that's what we're doing here. It's a little bit elitist in the way that it's impossible to sell those items or dishes for less and to compete with a chain. But that's what we're trying to sell those items in the best price possible, so they can have a market. We have an example here of a cheese supplier that it's from a region which is in the Amazon, and it's called Caquetá cheese because Caquetá is the region, and it's one of the two only cheeses that have an appellation of origin here in the country. And we have developed the supply chain with them. We started, I don't know, buying them 230 kilograms, and now we're buying 2.5 tons from them. But it has been a process in which we involve our executive chefs, our chefs. We take them to where the farmers are and developing our dishes to help those suppliers. And I think that that's what all of the restaurants should focus on. For chains or a McDonald's, it's impossible to do that, to sell for $1 menus, but for the rest of the restaurant industry, I think that the responsibility has to be towards there. I don't know if I'm clear with that.
I think you're being very clear on that. And I think that it's interesting all of the differences you guys have brought up kind of between the smaller local food systems that you're familiar with as a contrast with the larger industrial food system. And one of the things that I think has reached all of us around the world.
Sorry, and there's another particular thing here in Colombia. Yeah. Which is we don't have seasons. We're close to the equator, so there are many compared to Europe or the States. We have many of our products are produced during the whole year, and that's an advantage that we have to take. We can buy those tomatoes that Catherine is every the whole year round. So. We also have to take advantage that we have that here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, speaking about the seasons, coming to you, Caterina, on a serious note as well, springtime is the busiest season, as you sort of brought up, for farmers. And one of the fears that we have with the pandemic sort of taking hold during the spring season is that there could be labor shortages on farms during a very important time for harvesting and planting. I was wondering if you could speak to this a little bit, what your experience is with your farm and why it might be that these labor shortages could disrupt the food system later on.
Yes, it's a concern that has been like raised, and it's raising, especially here in Europe. So maybe I can, like, let's say, talk for Europe in this case, which is that for most of agriculture, of the agricultural sector, the whole sector relies on foreign workers. So workers that would come just for the season, for example, to harvest tomatoes or to, I don't know, For the spring and summer season, which is where the most of the harvests are done, there are foreign workers coming, not necessarily from like extra European countries, but also from other European countries, to Italy, to France, to Spain, to Germany, to all the big agricultural like countries. And this, in the situation of COVID, is impossible, because even within Europe, I don't know if you guys know, but even within Europe, the borders are closed. And so if like a worker from Slovenia would like to come to Italy to do the I don't know, the wine season, for example, he could not come. So this is one thing. And second thing is also that it's a very bad thing, but there is also, I mean, industrial agriculture is also relying massively on illegal workers. So not only immigrant workers, but they're also with no job contract, no social protection, social security, nothing. And so this is even like harder in a case of a pandemic like COVID, because these people are not protected. Even those who are, for example, on the Italian, speaking about Italy, those who are based in Italy, they're not protected. And so this is why it's very, very complicated. I'd say on a macroeconomic level and on a larger scale. Our farm is not impacted by that at all, because our workers are being with us forever, basically. I mean, you know, they're all like permanent workers, so they've been here for years now, and so it's not like seasonal workers that we have. I'm sure it's going to be an issue. And I mean, I was reading some articles a couple of weeks ago, like I think it was in the UK or something like that. The British government was like kind of like shipping workers from Romania or I don't know from where to go help on the fields, or even I think it was like the French government calling all the unemployed people to go help on the farms or find work in farms because of this real labor and like workers shortage, which is real. And I think, you know, we're gonna suffer from that also, in the sense that my fear is also that the price of some food is gonna ramp up because of this.
Thank you. And Johnny, I want to come to you next. Your cooking at your restaurant in the past has often worked with foods that are perhaps, they call them tradition, and these traditions are often born out of times of hardship. Foods that use leftovers or use maybe less appealing parts of a certain vegetable or part of the animal to make something really delicious, but out of necessity. And I was wondering if you could speak at this time what we can learn from these traditional foods that came out of difficult times as well.
Right. I mean, that's actually, before I jump into that directly, I think that ties into some of the things that both Santiago and Kat were talking about, was that just the very idea of some of the things that we're having conversation about kind of shows where we are socially. People shouldn't be going to work on farms because there's labor shortages, right? People shouldn't have to source food, right? The social distancing and everything is so difficult solely because of the food. It's not because want to be around each other so bad, it's because people need to get out to go find and source food. It doesn't make sense, and there's enough land on this earth for every single human being to be able to have a quarter acre of land, right? On a quarter of an acre of land, you can grow a year's supply of food, right? And I know this affects my business, it will affect Kat's, and it affects Santiago's. We're working too hard for something that we should all be doing already. You know, everybody should have their own land to be able to grow their own food. Food is money, right? You see governments giving out stimulus checks, but they're not giving out any land. Money is stimulus checks and cash, and capitalism is all taxable. You give it, you take it away. But you can't print any more land, right? The earth isn't going to, you know, we're not going to have a lot of volcanoes going off at one time and other islands popping up out of the water. We have what we have, and we need to use what we have to our advantage. If every Santiago had his land and he grew his own food, and him and his family could harvest and grow themselves, and Cat did the same, and they lived in the same country or in the same city or in the same vicinity, they could be able to barter and trade with each other. And then they can still have other skills in life that they can make real money off of, right? But we've got so far away from tradition that we innovatively screw ourselves over. If everybody could grow their own food, there would be no issues with food. If we started school education with growing food, you have kids, like to Kat's point, we spend more money on our exterior than our interior. And food should cost a lot, not because of a shortage of wages or a shortage of anything else, just simply on quality. Every eat or drink something, you have the potential to die. I have a Gatorade right here, right? And bottle this somewhere. And I have to trust that they're taking care of this correctly. But it doesn't cost that much. There's no safety in this. But if I pay twice as much for a local buffet that makes it, then maybe I know that my food is safe. I feel like that's why we should pay more for quality versus us saying, well, we're going to pay for quality sparingly versus it being high quality all the time. And when it comes back to looking at the traditional, speaking of, I think that's the difference, kind of the difference between where our food is coming from versus a few other places, is for people, Black people that live in the United States, our cultural food is based off of survival versus places like Italy. These places, these foods have been based off survival of so many things collectively that their countries have thrived and created cultures from their pest class of years ago. For here in the United States, Black Americans don't get that afforded that opportunity. Our foods have always been made from scraps and leftovers, never made from organic, fresh, high quality ingredients. That's why we call it neo soul food, because now we're taking traditional foods that were made with scraps and leftovers, and now making those same dishes with the highest the ingredients that we can possibly find, which I think gives the same flavor and the same experience, but the taste is tenfold because the ingredients are better.
And Tony, would you think that neo soul food is taking on a new meaning during the pandemic?
I don't think it's taking on a new meaning during the pandemic, but I think it's becoming our reason to do more, or to get those things that we have that haven't been afforded to us. Oftentimes, a big conversation in the United States right now is for, you know, people of color, specifically Afro-Americans, is reparations. And so many times I've seen the conversation come up and money be the first thing that we speak about, and we should reparate with land versus anything else. And then us having that land would give Neil soul food the stage that it deserves. Soul food classically, like I said, is made of things that aren't that great. But neo soul food is people of African descent taking what's owed to us and making those same things that we made before, but making them better, us finally getting what we were owed, and that being land.
And Santiago, I was wondering, I'd like to know more about Colombian food from your perspective. Do you think, you know, Johnny's been shedding a little light on, you know, soul food and some of the traditions from his community. Could you tell us a little bit about Colombian food and Colombian food culture?
Well, what we do is we have a few restaurants with different concepts, and we don't have a restaurant of specifically Colombian food. What we do is we care about our local products, and we try to put those products in our menus. And but if you want to talk about a little bit about Colombian food, we have many indigenous roots, and like most of the countries, most of the typical or local cuisine comes from there. After the the mixture when the Spanish conquered us and with the indigenous traditions, most of the dishes come from there. And the cuisine is a little bit divided by regions, or we have departamentos, which are like states. And most of the dishes depend more on the state than what you find around. So we have like five big regions. One region is the central region where we're located. The capital is in the middle of the country, and it's 2,600 meters above sea level. So most of the food from here are stews and comfort food because of the weather or the altitude here. And we have we go towards the north, or we have a Pacific coast and a Caribbean coast, and the local cuisine from there is totally different than most fishes or shellfishes and a lot of fried stuff, because it's very Caribbean in the northern part of Colombia. And but the nice thing is that here in Bogota you have everything from all of the regions, and it's a mixture of that. And what the new generation of chefs are doing here is the best way to use the local ingredients to expose our cuisine in a modern way. Not the modern way with the extravaganza of what happened 10 years ago, but in a really humble and well plated dish, or with the techniques they've learned in their experiences traveling around the world. So what we have right now as like local cuisine restaurants here is more of that mixture of good techniques with a very beautiful and good local product, and in a very simple way. I think that's happening around the world, and I think Johnny is doing the same there. And the ingredients that Katerina is catering is the one that these people are using. Same everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so we don't have a whole lot of time here, so I do want to start coming to group questions. And one of the beautiful things about us being able to have this conversation right now is the fact that we are all coming from different cultures and being in different countries. And so I would like for all of you to kind of speak to what you've learned from the experience of working with food during the pandemic, and then also if you're able and willing to shed any insight on some of the most successful things that you've done for your business during this period and what you might advise other similar companies to pursue. So how about we start with you, Kat?
Yes, so I mean, I think one of the most important things that we've been learning, we are learning now in the situation, is that it's okay not to know, and it's like something very like from a human perspective. It was very like first weeks for us were really like we were really stressing out, and we wouldn't know, you know, like what was good for employees, what was safe for them. We were wondering whether to do or not to do home delivery because of like our concerns for the health of our employees. We were trying to, you know, accommodate with like kind of like contradictory news that we were getting from the government, from the local government. So it was really, really hard. But I think that what's teaching us is first that this is an incredible momentum for us, especially, I mean, I speak as farmers, to speak about what we do and how we do it, and to really build community, local communities around us, because now people have the time and people have the will to hear and to know about their food, and they also have the time and the will to cook their food, which is something that, you know, may be tricky in normal times. Even though in Italy, let's say, people cook on average more than in other countries. What's been very good and very surprising for us, it's also, for example, as regards to home delivery, because we finally decided to start doing home delivery. And the funny thing about that is that we're a small farm, we have limited resources, and so for the home delivery we chose not to give the people the chance or the opportunity to choose the different kind of veggies that they would want for home delivery. So we created some sort of like a mixed boxes of veggies with two sizes, with like on average, let's say 8 to 9 different varieties of veggies, so people can really have stuff to do, like raw stuff to cook and things like that. And it's been something that we tried to do actually some sort of like CSA model for years, and it never really worked before, because people in Italy really love to come to the market or to come to the farm and pick and choose their veggies. Whether now they can't, because a lot of people cannot move, and so it's working, and people are super happy to buy like a box of veggies where they cannot choose the content. What we're trying to do to help them with that, because I mean, we know that it's not easy sometimes, you know, you never cooked leeks and then you have a box that has leeks in it. So what we're doing is that we're sharing with them a lot of recipes, very easy. It's mostly stuff that I cook myself for myself, so limited amount of time, maximum 30 minutes. And it's been very well received, and people are really loving that. And one thing that we also really focus on is also food waste, because, you know, just to give you a very simple example, like the leeks, most of the people don't know how to cook them, so they would rather like just cut the white part and use that, and then discard the green part. And it's like you're basically losing half of the produce, and it's like it's a nonsense, even more in this situation. So we teach people, for example, how to cook leeks, like the green leeks. We also do some little like very easy posts on maybe Instagram or social networks on how to empty your fridge. Like, you know, if you have, I don't know, cabbages or like leftovers, we're, you know, teaching people very quickly to ferment that. And it's something that anyone can do. And, you know, we all have a little bit of time now at our homes to do these kind of things. And so I think this is very, very well received. And I think it's very important to share this kind of information with the people. And then what we're trying to do is also to kind of create this connection that people are not experiencing at the moment because they can't see us, by sharing the more that we can on social media, but not only like the pretty stuff, but also like really what we do, like when we transplant, when we do these things.
Yeah, absolutely. And so, Johnny, how about you? What are some of the lessons that you've learned during this experience that you'd like to share with our international audience?
Aching for acres. Land is important. It's severely important. It's more important than anything that anybody's fighting for or even thinking about. If it's not this pandemic, it'll be something else. And then after this one, it'll be another thing. There's always going to be something. And the uniform item that you can use to fight back and be able to sustain life is land. And that's the biggest thing. I would also say preserving foods is the biggest thing. Just as Kat was saying, you have a waste. And it's so unnecessary to have that kind of food waste. It's so important to not only have land to grow your own food, but have the means and the knowledge to preserve your own foods. When you preserve those foods, they turn into so many other things outside of just something you can pick up and eat, whether it be a sauce or a bed of that condition. Those are the two biggest things that I think can be taken away from any of this is not just having food for right now, but having food for years to come. So growing things in abundance and preserving them in abundance, not getting canned food banks and things like such. You want to be able to touch every single thing that you're eating. And then in retrospect, you can then barter those things with other people. Social media has ruined some of the human compassion and the human conversation and things like such. So I truly think that this has been a blessing in disguise for many of us in a lot of different ways, because this kind of shows how far into innovation we really are and how far off from tradition we've moved away from, and how we truly need both moving forward for the food world. I've also seen a lot of, conversations about, immigrant workers and them not having jobs in restaurants. That's not really the overlaying issue, right? A lot of people are using those things to spearhead conversations about, them needing to get their restaurant back open so that they can get their employees their jobs, right? As employers, your job shouldn't be to just employ people. It should be to educate people so that they can have those things themselves. It's more important that your employees can absorb the information, absorb that knowledge, and then create themselves. Steel sharpens steel. Competition is good for each other, but you don't necessarily have to compete with each other in a negative or derogatory manner. It'll be better if we all have it and create variety. So I would say that in restaurants, in regard to restaurants, and I would say the owning of the land would probably be right at the top. Owning land and preserving foods are my top two out of all of this.
Yeah, I agree. And Santiago, do you have any final words you'd like to share before we turn over for a quick round of questions?
Yeah, and so here the system, the labor system or the legal labor system has forced us or to keep our employees in our payroll. So we don't have unemployment subsidized or like in the rest of the world or in Europe or in the US. So that has like led us to find ways to keep our people busy or unemployed. And the other thing is that all of these initiatives, like the Spensa Takami Pantry, or what we've done with the deliveries that we previously had, the lessons are like, don't think too much. We have to act quick and fast. Before, we were a big company that any of the initiatives that were proposed on a table took months to start, and now it's a thing of 3 days. If you don't act quickly, like, you're gonna be lost. And I think that that until we have the cure or the vaccine for COVID, we're not gonna be safe at all. And I think that we are looking to cater people at home. And I think that all of us have to think that our model has shifted towards there. And we're looking how to serve the people that are going to be at home. And I think that after this crisis, many people are going to still be working at home because they found that we can do this conference via Zoom. We can do a lot of things digitally. So I think that we've learned a lot of about logistics, digital channels, and improving the speed of things to be created and set it up and rolling out and trying. If you don't try, you're not gonna know if it's gonna work or not.
Absolutely. All right. Well, Antonio, should we go ahead and get some questions from the audience?
Yeah, totally. So if anybody, I see like lots of engagement happening in the live chat, which has just been amazing from people all around the world. Outside of asking some questions, people are just commenting and just chiming in. But if you have any questions now, we'll get to just a few of them. But if you have any questions now, put them in the YouTube chat right now. And I just wanted to, before we actually get into the audience questions, so anybody who wants to put in a last minute question here, I actually want to pose a question to the panelists. If anybody has a question to each other, because I think this is a great opportunity for someone in Houston to ask someone in Italy, to ask someone in Colombia. So I'm here in LA, Elena's in Tuscany, Santiago in Bogota, Johnny in Houston, and Caterina in also in Italy. So if any of you panelists have a question to each other, let's get into that.
Yeah, I got a question for Kat. You were talking about, you know, having that land, having that driving force of business for like 30 years. I've always been told that it's easy to get it, but it's hard to keep, you know, and I'm just curious some of those things that you experience, you know, and not only maintaining your integrity as being organic, but maintaining your integrity of like, you want having things in that constant cycle. Do that? How did your family do that? You know, what were some of the challenges that you guys experienced in maintaining what you guys and what your grandfather had already built?
That's a very good question. And that's also one of the reasons why I decided to take over this farm, because of this, like, kind of, I mean, for me, it was sort of like more of like a moral and spiritual heritage as well, because I grew up here. Then I traveled the world. I lived abroad for almost 10 years. I mean, my whole passion, my whole engagement in food and sustainability, it literally comes from this farm. It comes from me being a kid and, you know, taking out the carrots from the soil and eating them like dirty, but so good, and eating like the tomatoes sun-ripe, still like warm from the sun. It's these kind of things. And I think that, you know, for me, this farm represents some, like, the, I would say the concrete or tangible translation of what food is, which is like the language of love, the universal language of love. And it's by taking care of our land that we can do that. I mean, the challenges, like more like, you know, operational challenges that have been, for example, the fact that this farm has been familiar for so long. And then, you know, it's based on the work of the family. And then, you know, grandparents passed away, my parents grow old. And so it has an add to transition from a family-based farm to a family farm, but that also has employees. And this is completely different. And you have to think about the business model. You have to think about the operations, because it's not people of the family. So you really have to make it work and to make it different and to make it more entrepreneurial as well. And I think that the other thing I want to talk about when it comes to the farm and the land is that is the soil fertility and the soil as like a, like our, I mean, it's not just the land, our that it's our, let's say, asset or our treasure. The real treasure in here is the life on the land. And because there is no point in having land if the soil is dead and if there is like no life in that. And so, I mean, I think that especially for farms that have been there for long, one of the main challenges is how to be able to keep the fertility of the soil and even increase it in 30 years. Because if you're just like extracting the resources from the soil, well, you're going to end up having a desert instead of a farm, even if you're just like organic and not using any pesticides.
You get out what you put in.
Yeah, exactly.
All right. Also, I have a question for Caterina. So how all this thing has affected your previous way to sell to, I don't know if you had like restaurants who bought from your farm, and like how all the restaurants that were closed or are starting to open has affected your business?
We have been like traditionally selling mostly to customers, so mostly to people. And this has been something that's, you know, it's been there for 30 years. So our business is based on sales that we do at the city market and on the farm. What's interesting and what has very much changed is that, we also sell to restaurants, but it's something that it's pretty new. It's since I came on, since I arrived at the farm. So it's been like 2 years and something that we're really creating this branch of let's say the farm that is selling food to the restaurants. So what's interesting in terms of shifts is, okay, the restaurant part is gone, completely gone since the COVID. But what's changing also is the fact that, for example, we still have markets in Italy, but they're very much regulated. So now they're kind of fenced and people cannot, there's a limited number of people that can go in and you have to wear masks and gloves and stuff like that. So what we've been experiencing is on one side, a decrease in sales at the market because it's been more complicated for people to come to the market. Also because in Italy, the measures were so strict, so people could not move from their municipality, meaning that just people from the outskirts of my city, they could not come to the city center or to somewhere in the city for the market. But what we've seen is also that there's been more people coming to our farm and the shop that we have at the farm because there is a lot of space because it's, you know, probably for people it's nicer. They, you know, our farm is really like a garden and it's really in the city, so they can come by bike, they can come on foot, they can park easily. There is like less of a concern or of like I'm standing too close to the other person because there is a lot of space and we're able to keep all the safety distances. So this is very interesting. And then there is the whole home delivery thing that we didn't do before. So, and we're trying actually to also for the home delivery, we're trying to partner with other producers that we know and that are producing stuff that we don't produce, for example, like a goat cheese or flour or pasta or things like that, because we would like our customers to like source and buy local the more they can. And if you offer them like sort of like a little platform, which is totally bootstrapped, is only like, you know, they order via WhatsApp and it's me answering. So it's
that's how we started.
But it's for us it's a way to support other producers that we like and that we share values with, and also to tell people, hey, you know, there's also this other guy who's producing amazing things 20 kilometers from your house.
Okay. I just want to jump in here, guys, to get a couple questions from our audience. Here comes one from T. Valle. She says, "Well, I never thought about access to local foods only to the elites. Thank you for bringing that to our awareness. But what can we do to manage that imbalance?
Get you some land. Get you some land. That's just land. And then whether it be for yourself or not, you can always take it and sell whatever you have for a lower price to the people that don't have access to it."
Any additional thoughts from Santiago or Caterina?
I couldn't hear the full question. So if you could repeat, Antonio, sorry.
The question was, I never thought about access to local foods only to the elites. What can we do to manage that imbalance?
Okay. Go ahead, Santiago.
Well, I think that these digital platforms will help for sure. Because you're investing in the digital platform and on the logistics and the channel, but I think that real estate is also a big part of this whole thing in the world, and the impossibility to have a grocery store in many parts of cities, and rents and everything is also what is like blocking the distribution of this. So I think that that having like very easy ways to distribute and these new channels and platforms or WhatsApps or everything, it's what's happening right now. And like, as Katerina was telling, like, I'm receiving orders from anyone who sends a message to my WhatsApp. So I think that that's changing a little bit, but still there's a part of the pricing that it's going to be a challenge.
Yeah, I agree. I think that it's there is like a balance that has to be found. And I mean, from our side, for example, what we are trying to do is, especially when it comes to the mixed boxes of veggies, we try to make them affordable and accessible, in the sense that, for example, just to give you an example, like the 3 kilos box with like a lot of different veggies inside is 10 euros and the 5 kilos is 15 euros, which is like $10, $15. I agree, it's something that, you know, middle class people can afford, or but it's, I mean, it's not so much if you think about this gives you like enough healthy and nutritious food for a week to cook with. So this is one thing. And I think that, you know, there's also still like another thing, which is like the accessibility of this food also for people that really cannot afford that. And what we are trying to do, and it's very small, but we also have like limited resources. We gift our food for people in need. And we have partnership with like local NGOs and you know, whenever we have like a little surplus or like whenever we can, we just gift this food for families in need. Yeah, I think that's one thing. And I mean, my dream is a little bit like what Johnny was saying, even though it's like, let's say, counterproductive for my work. But my dream is to transform part of my farm in like little gardens for people, so they can grow their own food and we can help them.
Johnny, this question is for you from Sarah Elizabeth Vogel. She asked, what role should local, state, and federal governments play in providing food security to communities?
None. I look at it when you, often when we talk about freedom, whether it be freedom of the press or anything else in the United States, freedom doesn't come with an attachment to somebody else helping you. Freedom comes with the attachment of you helping yourself, regardless of how. That doesn't mean you can't look for help, because the U.S. subsidizes a lot of things for worldwide farmers all the time. So it isn't the idea of not needing help. It's the idea of ownership, right? Ownership. The U.S. government, any government, has their own plans and have their own ideas that are separate from yours and from your families. Why would you want to put that in jeopardy? That would be my biggest thing. And then the next thing is, you talk about security and safety. Every time you eat or you drink or consume anything that is going into your body, it could potentially kill you. Who do you trust cooking more so than yourself? You know, and then maybe your neighbor has land as well, and now you trust your neighbor, or you trust, you know, your neighbors to your left and right, and now the three of you guys are bartering with each other. I really think that we have to move towards an ecosystem to where we rely on ourselves to eat and each other to eat, and not on governmental entities to do so.
One last question here that I want to ask, and then we'll wrap things up. On that same note, Johnny, that you were just talking about, this is from BLT Grant. How can we build momentum and continue the re-engagement with home cooking that's come out of the stay-at-home orders, so that it isn't lost when orders begin to lift?
Man, the key to everything I truly believe is getting land. Kat has already got it figured out. You know, she has land to be able to, right? The second that you have land, all those other things become a little bit more. And that doesn't mean that you have to own 20 acres of land or you got to own 10 acres of land. You know, two small families could go half in on half an acre of land and just grow food together. They don't have to live there. They just have to grow that food together. You can live somewhere totally separate from where your food is being grown at. It just means that you now have control of that. So when you think of cooking at home, think of cooking at home as well.
I think that the cook at home, like ideas that many of the restaurants around the world came out with for this crisis, it's like another category that we didn't have before, or only a few. And I think that that they're gonna stay, as I said, more people are gonna be working at home and spending time at home. And I think that there's an opportunity for restaurants to do it in the right way, or like the packaging, the way they teach people how to use it, like the innovation of the experience at home. It's a new challenge for all of us who are selling these items.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it's also, and maybe, I mean, call me romantic or something, but I think that one important thing about this whole crisis, it's that even, like, you know, we've all been, like, in different situations, and we are, I mean, I put myself in the privilege box for that, but I think that one important thing about this crisis is that it really helped us, like, focus on what's essential. And what's essential is to spend time with our families, to take care of the people we love, to take care of what we put in our bodies, and all these things. And that's why I have hope for people to continue cooking at home, because it's, at the end, it's just like it's such an important thing. And probably we were, like, too busy being in a rat race somehow, that we lost touch with that. And I mean, it's something, you know, that is gonna maybe take I don't know, more time than expected and everything, but I do really hope that people are really starting to grow their own food, and I do hope that they're gonna figure out that, you know, there are like new ways of, like, living, and there is a way also to have this time allocated for the important things in our lives. So,
well said. Well, we just we're here at the end of our panel, our webinar. I want to thank Elena, Santiago, Johnny, and Katarina for joining us, and I want to thank everybody who joined us on YouTube, on the live stream. There's going to be many more webinars, and we're wanting to offer this as free education and just free conversations, global conversations about these struggles and these issues around this pandemic, around our food ways, around home cooking, and also the resiliency that it comes within this industry. And I think it's very important to have these conversations, to engage and to build our community, especially now that we're all facing the same challenge. It's a form of solidarity. So we thank you for everybody who attended. There's going to be many more, so feel free to follow us on lifeintime.com or at lifeintime on any of the socials. Join our newsletter to see our next webinar and all the amazing content that we've got planned. Thank you, everybody, and be blessed. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Thank you.